Amen.
Every
20.
You can only
We will, if you will be, yeah,
wasn't the night falling, I've been hearing that all morning. Anyway, children, we are going to go to children's church, so if you will head towards the back, if you are of age for that.
Okay, we're all go now, it's ready. Amen. Well, hopefully you've enjoyed your day here at the church. Easter Sunday. Today I'd like to continue and finish off of a third part of a series we've been on for the past few weeks called Why the Cross? Why was the cross of Jesus Christ so important? We've looked at a lot of different scenarios, but this one kind of climaxes the whole purpose, doesn't it? Jesus, on Good Friday, was stretched from 12 o'clock till 3 p.m., the Bible declares. For the 3 hours he was held, stretched his arms out, with spikes in his wrist and in his feet. His side was pierced. His head had a crown of thorns. His body was aching from lack of water. Dehydration, I'm sure, was very painful at that time. He was offered a type of vinegar to drink, and he refused it. He did not want to have any kind of comfort during this time because he knew the pain and the seriousness of what sin is. Sin, to define, is the willful transgression against a known law of God. That's what John Wesley said. Sin is anything that we do that walks away from what God wants for our life. When we choose to live a life on our own, and we kind of, I don't know if I can say this on Sunday morning, thumb our nose at God, but when we kind of, something like that, kind of say, it's my way, God, not your, it's my life, not your life to be lived. When we push Him away, aside, and try to live our life, and then when we get into trouble, for some reason, so many times, so many people say, oh, God, help me. God, save me. Wonder what would happen if God said, sorry, I've just done my nails and can't do anything about that for you today. Can you call my office and make an appointment? It might take you about 300 or 400 years, but I'm sure we'll get to it one of these days. What if God just simply blew us off like we blow Him off at times? It's just a thought. The day of understanding about getting off the cross was so important, but for the time that Jesus was on the cross, He needed to stay the entire time, didn't He? Because He could not come down from the cross, and we would have no benefit from His death if He was relieved from the cross, if He had been healed on the cross. He, as the song we've had, many people have sung in the past, He could have called 10,000 angels to come to His rescue, but He died alone for you and for me. Why did He do it? Because He was extending His hands by saying, I love you this much. I'm willing to die for you. That you, when He said, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. He wasn't speaking about the Roman soldiers. He wasn't speaking about Pilate. He wasn't speaking about the chief priests and the religious, quote, leaders of the day. He was talking about, in 2016, even those at First Church of the Nazarene here in Tallahassee, Florida, he's speaking about every one of us in the sanctuary today that we did not know what we were doing.
Amen.
He knows what the power of sin is. You see, God is not hemmed in because of time and space continuum.
Amen.
He has the past, present, and future. He can go beyond that. And He already knew even what was about to happen in your life. Does He know that what the outcome is going to be? He's waiting. He knows what the outcome is going to be. But He's waiting on you to put your trust and full confidence within Him. Yes. And I pray that's what you've made the decision for this day. For I believe that's why you're in this house today. You're not here by accident. I believe you're here by divine appointment. I believe that in my heart that God has allowed you to come to this very house, this very day. You could have chosen hundreds of churches to go to in the city of Tallahassee alone. You could have gone to some really large churches. And you could have gone to some really small churches. We're not a small church. We're a big church waiting to do whatever God wants us to be. We're waiting to see what He's wanting us. In fact, the truth is, He's really waiting on us. That's what it is. He's waiting on us. Today, this message about getting off the cross, and you have an outline within your worship folder, I want to talk by beginning about a person who is the most successful trial lawyer that appears in history, according to the authoritative Guinness Book World of Records. Now, I don't know how authoritative that is, but it seems like they're pretty good at what they do. And on page 547 of their one of their books, it says, there's a gentleman named Sir Lionel Luckhoo. Out of 245 successful cases of murder charges acquitted by January the 1st of 1985. Now, he's a man who began his practice in 1940. So during that period of time, it's just unheard of. If you're an attorney, you know what I'm saying. It's difficult to win many cases, much less 245 successive murder cases. Now, maybe you're asking, well, what in the world does he have to do with Easter Sunday? That's a good question, because I think it ties right in what Easter Sunday is all about. So many times when you and I were growing up, we probably were asked by people saying, you believe what? You go to a church? Really? Well, it wasn't that way when I was growing up. I thought everybody went to church, and I didn't go to church. And nowadays I go, and it seems like a lot of people are not going. What is it about people not wanting to go to church? We don't kill people here. We love you. We feed you way too much food. I used to be skinny at one time. I tell you what. Too much. But we have people who will love you here. What is it about fear of church that people just don't buy into? I think it's because of the eternal is where it's at. Because it's hard to face God every Sunday and hear the truth looking at us. And if we would just say yes to Him, you wouldn't have that conviction on week in and week out. Because the Holy Spirit of God, thank God for it, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, has come. He's the one who comes to convict us and to convince us of the way and the direction of our lives. Luckhoo, how he fits in is this, because today is Easter Sunday, and as we look at Easter, wouldn't it be interesting, at least to me it is, to have someone of his expertise, someone of his caliber, someone to actually go in and do a study and try the test of what you do as an attorney to find the validity, to see if it's really approachable. In other words, did the resurrection really occur? According to the test that he would use as an attorney. To help someone to get off for murder, I think he could actually go in and find that Barabbas really was guilty and Jesus was not guilty. Well, here's what came about. He made this statement. Luckhoo said, I say unequivocally that the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ is so overwhelming that it compels acceptance by proof, which leaves absolutely no room for doubt. That's an amazing thought, I think, to know here Luckhoo, this person who has studied and done so much for his time, knighted by the Queen of England twice, such an incredible man that he was. But he reminds me today of a couple other truths. Number one, we know in our senses and our logic, pigs really don't fly. Santa Claus doesn't slide down chimneys. And dead men don't come back to life. But for some reason here, Luckhoo, I can't get away from him, because I did some more searching and found out one of the most logical things he could have done. Listen, this is the most intelligent thing anyone could have ever done. You know what he did? He gave his heart and life to Jesus Christ. He was so compelled by the evidence that he wound up surrendering his own life to Jesus Christ. Now that's evidential. That is so good to know that someone would be willing to give their very life to Christ for what they have searched. Today I want to look at two things. One, what are the non-disputed facts about Easter? And secondly, what does Easter really prove to us today? Let's look at the first one. You have some outlined in your worship folder, and I've given you all the answers so you'll know what they are, so you'll know where I'm at as you follow through, okay? Number one, the non-disputed facts, the first one is, Jesus died and was buried. Jesus died and was buried. It was confirmed by the Roman soldiers when they came back and had stood there at the cross when Jesus had died, and the other two thieves that were caught who were on the side of Jesus. Now, Pilate, the one who actually caused this whole thing to occur, he didn't even know that Jesus had died until the military captain in charge came back to Pilate and said, "It is finished. He is dead." And at that point, Joseph of Arimathea, part of the Sanhedrin, one of the religious leaders of that day, came, who was also a believer in Christ. He came and asked for permission from Pilate if he could have the body of Jesus. For Joseph of Arimathea had this rock that was dug out. No body had ever been placed into it. And that day, he was able to take Jesus down from the cross, put him in to the grave, and on that day, it had to happen soon because Passover began at 6 p.m. Now, Jesus died on the cross about 3 p.m., had to be in the grave before 6 p.m. because they were not allowed to do any kind of work or any kind of thing about burial. It had to happen soon. So therefore, he died and the first day starts ticking. Day 2 picks up at 6 p.m. that evening and goes through the next day. Day 3 picks up at 6 p.m. that next evening, coming into Sunday overnight, Sunday morning. You see the third day? All of a sudden, what happens is there's so many things starting to occur. Before the third day arrived, though, the chief priest came to Pilate and said, "We're having a problem here. Our problem is this. Jesus said he would rise on the third day. Now, we know dead people don't rise from the dead, don't we, Pilate?" And Pilate, "Sure," he said, "that's correct." He says, "Well, we'd like to ask a favor from you. Would you please put a guard on the tomb?" Because you see, when Joseph of Arimathea, when the body was put into the tomb, this large stone was rolled in place. He said, "Could you have a guard kind of seal the tomb to protect it? Because here's what's going to happen. It's going to be worse than if his disciples come in the middle of the night and take the body out. They'll say that he's resurrected, and there'll be no proof." So Pilate simply says, "Okay, make it so." So he sends out a troop, and the guards go out. Somewhere between 10 to 30 soldiers have gone out now to cover this time, to appease these chief priests, these Jewish leaders. During that time, they take a rope, and they wrap it. Think of an X pattern. They wrap rope this rock, and they sealed it with wax so that no one could cross that seal. To break that seal meant certain death. And any soldier that was found asleep on the job was put to death. So it was really behooved them, it was really important for them to take charge of this and take it serious. Now, a lot of these soldiers probably blew this off and thought, "That's no big deal. It's just another dead man. We're just not a problem here whatsoever." Ah, but that's where we really start to pick this up. Because the tomb was sealed and guarded, and number 3, the tomb was found empty 3 days later. 3 days later. The Bible says in John 20, verses 6 and 7, Simon Peter runs and finds inside the grave that he notices the linen wrappings lying there with the cloth that had been covering the head of Jesus was folded up and lying to the side. Now, to me, it just brings a couple of images to my mind. The brave disciples found out from the women. You see, somewhere in society, even in the United States, there was a time when women didn't have even any kind of rights. And then they were allowed to vote. Then they were allowed to smoke. And then there's all kinds of things they've been allowed to do. Truth is, men might be in charge, but it's women who turn the necks of the heads of the men who think they're in charge. Amen?
Amen.
I'm just teasing, man. We've got to come together, man. Come on, we've got to rise up. In this tomb, I can see Simon standing there. He's run, because he's run to the tomb to find this cloth. And as Mary's, the ladies who have come and said, "He's alive. He's alive. He's not in the tomb. We have seen him. We've spoken with him." What? And Peter and John run to the tomb. And they get there and they find this cloth, this burial cloth. And I can see Simon doing something like this. A look of perplexion on his face. Shock. Then I see him doing this. with a big grin starting to come up. He's going, he's alive. He's alive. One of two things had to happen. Either Jesus was alive, or there was a man who's come alive and he's running around without any clothes on. I'd take the first one, amen? Because he was seen by so many different people. Let's look at that one in a moment. The witnesses claimed to have seen Jesus from his resurrection. You had the 11 disciples who had seen him, not the 12th one, which was Judas Iscariot. He went and hung himself out of his guilt. He was seen by the two men on the road to Emmaus. As they were walking by, there was a man who walked with these men. And all of a sudden, what's happening is, the one man, who's Jesus incognito, they don't know who he is, he's saying, what's going on here? What's all the commotion? Man, are you daft? What's wrong with you? They're Jesus. Jesus is just resurrected from the dead. Have you not heard about Jesus? No, tell me about him. I can see him doing that so easy. No, tell me some more. What do you know about Jesus? And all of a sudden, as they were talking, they turned away and looked. And as they looked back, Jesus was gone. And they said, where did he go? And all of a sudden they said, but while we spoke with him, were not our hearts warmed? Were we not feeling something special because of who he was? That's who Jesus is. He still is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. He was seen by more than 500 other people at one time, and then even was confronted by the Apostle Paul. And it happened over a 40-day period of time until Acts 1:11 took effect. And in that is when the angels came to receive Jesus, and they're being taken off from the mountain there. And all of a sudden, as they're leaving and going heavenward, Jesus is just kind of going up as he was on the cross. And the angels say in Acts 1:11, you men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing into the heavens? This same Jesus, which is being taken from you, will one day come back in like fashion. The Bible has just indicated in Acts 1:11 that there will be a second coming of Jesus Christ. The difficulty is, for some, they don't believe it. They don't believe he came. Some people don't believe he even came the first time. What do you believe today? I believe he came. Jesus came once. He's going to come a second time. Amen? Amen. I believe that. Number five, Christianity was founded on this very claim alone. The concept, I guess I kind of wonder off of this, more than 500 people saw Jesus, okay? Here's my question. What if they just made this story up? Here's my problem with that. If they just made this story up, are these men so willing to die and lose their lives over a lie? I believe they believed it because they know it was true. When you have a living experience with Jesus Christ, you're never the same. Your life is never the same. And people around you know it as well. You talk different. You act different. You think different. And the things when other people are telling the jokes and the things that you don't feel comfortable with, instead of beating them up or throwing water in their face, you're a gentleman. You're a woman. All of a sudden, there might be someplace else you need to go. And you excuse yourself. Or if need be, you confront them with love without condemnation. Because that's what Jesus did for us. Amen? So I'm thinking, how could they believe something that wasn't manufactured if it really wasn't true? Number six, the disciples died as martyrs. Every disciple, with the possible exception of John, died a horrendous death. You know why? Because they wouldn't stop telling what Jesus had done and that he had resurrected from the dead. And because of that, people put them to death. They threw them into the lions. They burned them at the stake. They filleted their bodies. Oh, that's something you tell on a Sunday morning. Yeah, they were tormented. They were tortured. Yeah. And the church grew under persecution. We have not had persecution in the United States of America, church. We have not had persecution like what these folks had.
It's coming.
And I believe you're right. I believe it's coming. And you're going to need to ante up, so to speak. If you're going to be a part of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, you need to be ready. The time will come. Well, that's just real encouraging. I thought it was supposed to be easy to be a Christian. No, it's a blessing to be a Christian. It's not always easy, but it's a blessing, amen, to walk with the Lord. Amen. And the last one is this. Leading into this, if we can understand some of the things that are undisputed about Jesus, without question, to prove that he had rose from the dead, that he truly is God in the flesh. So it leads us to the next question of this. What does Easter prove? I mean, what difference does it make? I mean, because Jesus died on a cross and was buried and rose on the third day, what difference does it make to you today? Well, first thing is this. It makes a difference to remind us that God is in control. You know, our life of maturity comes about when we start realizing we really don't control a lot of things in this world. Amen. Have you heard that yet? That's when you know that you're a mature person, that you've become older. My dad used to tell me things like that. He says, David, don't lie to me. I was a teenager one time. I said, no, you weren't. You were always old. That didn't help me at all. Most things in our life are beyond our control. For example, you and I cannot slow down time. You and I cannot control how much hair or how little hair we have. Some of us can't control whether we're going to be tall or short, big or bigger, or thinner. Lord, you know my heart. You know what I'm looking for. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for reducing me down. Amen. You and I cannot force people to think what we want. We cannot make people love us. And I cannot make you receive Jesus Christ in your heart. The things beyond our control. That's just the way life is. But out of this, God is always in control. My question to you is this. Maybe a little personal. What is out of control in your life that you need help with? You see, only God can help you. He's in control. He's perfect. He's not out of control. He can help you in every need that you have in your life. So if there's something in your life that you're out of control with, why not ask him? Why not talk to him? Hey, we love doctors. Not a problem. We have doctors in the service today. We love doctors. Thank you. Thank you for serving and what you do, every one of you. But frankly, I always ask the Father first what I should do. And so many times he sends me to you. And sometimes he just takes care of me. And sometimes I go to you and I still have the problem. Like my hand is still numb. It's been that way for 6 weeks. And I have a pinched nerve somewhere. But you know what? It hasn't slowed me down. I'm still plugging along. I hope that's okay with you. And I hope that you'll keep plugging along and not give up life just because you're hurting. Because that's just the way life is sometimes. Amen? It just happens that way. Amen. But God is in control. So whatever you need, let him help you. God can help you because he's in control. Number two I would say to you is this. God's promises are true. God has never left us or forsaken us. Amen? He never has. The Bible says in Mark chapter 8, verse 31, one of the most incredible promises that Jesus gave was this. He begins to tell them that he, the Son of Man, would suffer many terrible things and be rejected by the leaders and the leading priests and the teachers of the religious law, and that he would be killed. Came true, didn't it? Amen? Now, we weren't there. How do we believe it? Well, we believe it because of the people who have lived before us. There's something about when you know people are telling the truth. Can you tell that? When you look into someone's eyes, you can tell whether they're telling the truth or not. Now, maybe you can't see my eyes from where you are, and I can see some of your eyes from where I'm at. But how do you know when someone's telling the truth? Most often, they look right at you, and they peer right into your eyes. It's the people who sometimes tend to look away when they're talking with you. Our kids used to do that all the time. I was telling a story recently about our son, Brad. If you don't mind, I want to just quickly tell it again. Nita was looking one day about where the blueberries went. And she looked around, asked the kids, and she looks to Brad. Brad was just a little boy at that time. How old, what do you think he was? 5 years old. Brad was about 5 years of age. Now, he was our third son. And what he did was, he stood there, and she says, Brad, do you know where the blueberries went? He goes, no, ma'am. She says, smile for me. He says, and when he smiles, his teeth are purple. She says, Brad, did you happen to eat any blueberries? No, ma'am. He was guilty. He was guilty. He was cold. The problem is, the promise was, that his mother promised not to kill him. Because this is blueberries. It's not a big deal. But how do you deal with people not telling the truth? Sometimes they want to look away. And that's what he was trying to do. Because he could not look her straight in the eye and say that. Although he tried for a while. But he tends to look away. See, sometimes we do the same thing to God. And I believe a long time ago, I have believed this, and I still believe it. Sometimes people come to church and hide from God, even though they're right in front of him. Because it appears to everybody else, everything is fine. Friends, God is in control of your life. His promises are true. He'll work things out for you. He says, I'm going to do three things in your life. This is why his promise came true. One, God said, I will come to the earth and I'm going to show you how to live. Two, he said, I'm going to take away all the sin that you're willing to give to me. And number three, I'm going to show you how to get to heaven. That's what God said. That's his promise to you and to me today. He's in control. His promises are true. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9, that eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard, nor has it entered into the mind of those of what God has prepared for those who love him. Now the passage a minute ago says to everyone who believed in him, he would take care of. The whole issue here is this. If you want to have the blessing of God upon your life, you have to believe in him. Oh, I'm not saying like James 2:19 says that the devil believes in Jesus, but he trembles. Not that kind of belief. This is belief that you believe on him. You trust in him. It's like the pew that you're sitting in now. If you could just simply raise your hands and your feet off the ground. Oh, it feels good to sit down. You just raise your hands and feet like a roller coaster. And you take your feet off and your hands off. And you put everything that you have into the palms of the Lord your God. That's faith. That's trusting him with all that's inside of you. Third thing I would say to you, even though most people are really not living, the third thing is God really loves you. You see, most people are not living because they're just kind of existing. People are not worried about the plan necessarily that God has for their life. Most people, even those in this room today, most people are just kind of concerned about how can I get through this day? You have so many heavy things that you carry every day. And we try to put a good smile on our face and we try to look people right into the eye. But it's so hard sometimes, isn't it? It's difficult to carry such a heavy load. And God wants to help you. Hey, he's in control. His promises are true. But God, he really loves you. I want you to think about this. If you're married, men, how much do you love your wife? Ladies, how much do you love your man? I know I've been married over 40 years, and I've used this a lot of times as an example. I'm a greater friend, and she's a greater friend to me, to my wife, to Nita, than we ever were the first time we were. But I said the first time we were married. We weren't married the second time, we were married the first time. We have an intimacy within our lives and our hearts. That we can just be in the same room. We can sit on the same pew here and just sit beside each other and still have an intimate moment just sitting beside each other without even touching. Do you realize the Lord your God loves you so much? He wants to have an intimate moment with you every day. He wants to hear the rough times you've had at work. He wants to see the battles and let you know that he's with you and he's there going to help you through the battles you've struggled through throughout the day. The frustrations you've had, the temptations you've had. He wants to sit and laugh with you and be joyful with you. He wants to go through every part of your day. Why? Because he really loves you. He loves you with a love that nobody else in this room can love you with. He loves you so much, he willingly died for you. That's how much he loves you. And that's why he doesn't want you. Now think of it this way. No husband should ever want to walk away from the spouse that he is so in love with. But if a husband starts walking away from his spouse, Do you see where the unfaithfulness is? And you see where the jealousy rises up that can happen and the dangers and the pains that can occur? With the love of God, when you and I walk away from His love, it's the same thing. It's like we're seeking someone else to love. It's like we're wanting something else to meet the needs in our heart. And God wants to love you so much, He doesn't want anything to break that rhythm, that joy, that peace that He's putting inside of you, and the love that He has for you. Do you see? He loves you that much. The Apostle Paul said in Philippians 3, verse 10, I want to know Christ and the power of His resurrection. I want to know that I can stand on the day of trouble. The day of tribulation comes. I want to know and let Him know, let Christ know, that I stand with Him no matter what happens to my life. It may come, George. It may happen someday. We don't know when it's going to come. It could happen. But in the meantime, I need to live the most faithful life I can because I know He loves me. The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God. The B-I-B-L-E.
Amen.
Da-da-da. What did you do there?
More.
I've proven to you, I think, three things today. Because it's Easter, I believe I've proven to you, number one, God is in control. Number two, His promises are true. And number three, God really loves you. A question I have as we close, that for over 2,000 years, Jesus Christ has been caring for you and for me. And His name has been sullied. But you know what He wants? He wants you to get off of your cross. He wants you to get off of your cross that you feel like, everyone look at me. Look at the pain I'm going through. Look at the suffering I'm having. He wants you to have a peace of mind. He wants to give you a group of people who love you and will encourage you and stand with you in your tough times and laugh with you in your happy times and cry with you when you're having some other difficult moments. He wants to take away every sin that you may have in your life. God wants you to have confidence that no matter where you go, you stand tall and strong as the same trees that He's created that have stood for generations after generations. He wants you to be a part of His family. And it's all free. Why is it free? Because it's Easter. Because it's Easter, everything that God has given to us is free through Jesus Christ, His Son. Isn't it about time you come off of your cross? Isn't it about time that you're no longer afraid whether you're going to have a job or not have a job? Isn't it about time you come off the cross and not be afraid of your finances? Isn't it about time that you come off your cross and in relationships you're having a difficulty with someone else? Why not just go to them? Just take the initiative. Why not just go to them and say, I may have caused some pain or problem in our relationship, and I hope that we didn't. But if I did, I take responsibility. I take full responsibility for it. Don't put it on them to come to you. Why don't you just go to them? And if there's someone that you haven't spoken to for a long time, why not come off your cross instead of feeling like, well, they haven't talked to me, or well, I'm not going to talk to them. I've got family members like that. You know what we do? We just come and admit it and say I'm sorry. And just ask Him to help us. My sister was up here not long ago. She was staying with us. Seemed like she'd stay with us for about 6 years, it seemed like at times. And there are days siblings still have rivalry, it seemed like. And I felt like at times, I'm in charge of this house. You're just a visitor here. And what was happening, she was there also to help take care of our mother in those waning of moments. I had it out with my sister. Oh, it was a good out, it wasn't a bad out. There's some bad outs with people, there's blood and the weeping and shedding of blood, you know. And no, it wasn't that at all. It was a time of forgiveness, a time of weeping, a time of hugging, a time of love and saying, you're one of the most important people on this planet in my heart. I wish more families would do that. I wish more people would call and talk to people and say, hey, I miss you today. I love you. But it seems like we're so busy, we think we're busy doing the things that are important to us that the people that really are the most important to us, we're not giving them even any time. Well, speaking of time, it's just that time of the day. I kind of wonder, isn't it about time to come off the cross? I want to offer you something here today. If you're able to, if you're able to stand, you might not be able to, maybe just only sit and raise a hand. But I'd like to extend to you this one thing this very day. My sister and I, we got it all straightened out. She's a dear friend of mine, she always has been. But I felt like some of the things she was doing was not being helpful to my mother. We'd been there for 3.5 years, every day kind of watching her go downhill. And I became very protective of my mother. And my sister became kind of an outsider, it seemed like. But we got that all straightened out. We really did. I'm being honest. I'm trying to be clear here to you. It happens to all of us. But I miss my sister. I miss my brother. There's just 3 of us now. We had a big family. And they're all gone to heaven except 3 of us. I don't know who you have in your life or what pains you're having or what problems that's keeping you on a cross. Some of you, praise God, have come down off the cross and you've got it seemingly all together. But some of us are still maybe on the cross. Here's what I'll invite you, without even telling anybody here, God already knows our heart, amen? Are you okay with that? He knows your heart, he knows your heart. But the biggest thing that some of you may face today is that you're afraid to let anybody else know that you're going through a difficulty. One of the greatest steps of healing is to confess it. To admit, to confess, and to trust Jesus. And without you telling anybody else, because God already knows your heart, I'd like to invite you to do something. Now in the church, we have altars. Now many times people will come and pray at the altar. You're always welcome to do that. But without even extending that to you, I'd like to extend this offer to you this day. I'm not selling you a car. I'm not selling you a house. I'm not trying to tell you the best place in town to go eat today. I'm extending to you an opportunity to have the right to come off of the cross that you're on today. Because you don't have to stay on your cross any longer. Jesus resurrected, and you don't have to stay on the cross. So I want to invite you to do this. I want to invite you that if you feel like you've got something in your life that you cannot control, only God can take care of, and you know His promises are true, and you know that He really loves you, if you're going through something that you know is a battle, it's strong, and it's tough, and it's difficult, I'd like to invite you just to stand where you are as an offering to God, saying, I'm just going to stand out of faith, oh God, and you know my heart, and nobody else needs to know about it. So, Father, I'm just going to stand out of faith, and I'm going to come to you just as I am. Without one plea, I don't know what even to say, but I want to offer myself to you today. And I want to cry, and I want to crawl up in your lap. I want to be able to just know that I'm free, and by standing, you're going to be there with me, and you're going to take charge of my life, oh Lord. I just need you today, Lord. I just need you today. Would you just help me by watching me stand up here? Would you just help me? Oh Lord, take this from me today, and I give it to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Anybody else like to just stand as a testimony, saying, oh God, I just need to let you have it. Anybody else? There's people all around you standing who have made a confession today before you that there's something they're going through. It's not important whether I know or you know. What's important is that they stood before God Almighty to say, Lord, only you can take charge of this. And just go, wait a minute. Is there a song? Do we have the words on this one?
It's okay. When I survey the
anybody else just like to just honor the Lord today? Just say, I just have a need, O Lord, and I'm just going to stand right where I'm at. Take it, O Lord. I give it to you by faith. I give it to you by faith. He knows what it is. Praise Him. Rejoice in Him today because He's setting you free. We'll sing this one chorus. We'll be through today. house today. Thank you for everyone who stood and surrendered themselves to you to say, oh Lord, we have a need in our life and we know that only you can supply the need. And Father, we pray your richest blessings on everyone who is here this day. Lord, on our children, on every adult, grandma, grandpa, every aunt and uncle, every son and daughter, everyone, every child who's here. For Lord, the reality was nobody ever expected to find nobody in the tomb that day. But Lord, you rose again on the third day, and we have life everlasting because of it. Go now and bless everyone in your divine presence. And Lord, may we go and change our world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we pray these things. And all God's people said amen. If you love him today, give him a hand today. Amen. Let's praise him today. Amen. God bless you.